Good afternoon. What a great crowd for a rainy day at the end of the semester. Thank you so much for all coming out today. I'm Nancy Begranoff, Dean of the Robbins School, and we're delighted to have one of our own alums here to speak to us today. To introduce Kathleen Hughes, we have Kelly Becker. Kelly is a student who is a business administration major with concentrations in finance and economics. She spent last summer at the London School of Economics, and she'll be interning with J.P. Morgan this coming summer, and she's also going to be on our Student Managed Investment Fund. So Kelly, you want to come on up and introduce our speaker. Thank you.
I knew when I came to Richmond that I wanted to pursue business, but I didn't know where to start. I eventually decided that my first step would be to find role models who I could learn from and ask for advice. Someone who is talented, hardworking, and most importantly, proactive about their career. Our guest speaker tonight is just that person. She graduated from Richmond with a degree in economics and worked 10 years at J.P. Morgan's private bank in New York. In 2000, she moved to asset management in London, and in 2001, joined the liquidity business. By 2010, she had moved to Goldman Sachs and is currently the global head of liquidity sales. Describing her accomplishments as impressive would be an understatement. It is people like her that inspire students like myself to pursue our careers with passion and dedication. We are lucky and grateful for her time and advice, and please give a warm welcome to Kathleen Hughes.
Great, can you guys hear me okay?
Excellent. Thank you, Kelly, for that lovely intro. And thanks, Dean Begranoff, for inviting me to speak here tonight. It's been a long time since I've been at the University of Richmond, having lived in London for a while. But I appreciate you guys getting the weather right so I would feel at home today. That was very nice. I look back from when I left U of R, and that was 25 years ago. If you had $100 in 89 and invested that, just say, in the Dow, you would have over $800 today, so 500%-ish return on your investment. That's in spite of the fact that we have lived through and are maybe still living through the after effects of the Great Recession, right? So the worst economic crisis in nearly 100 years. You'd still have that sort of return on your money. But the Great Recession and the global financial crisis isn't the only crisis that we've had since I've left university, so I thought I would recap them for you now. 89 and 90, we had the savings and loan crisis right here in the US, where savings and loan banks were failing, they were mismanaged, they were losing money on investments, and they had to be bailed out by the government. Does that sound familiar at all? So that's 89. 1990, you had Japan. You had Japan bubble burst, the Japanese bubble burst, and they had two decades of a happy depression, which they're sort of getting out of now, or that's what the government there is looking to do. After Japan, also in 1990, though, you had the Scandinavian banking crisis. So you had widespread bank failures in the Scandies. Again, banks had to be rescued by their governments. 92-3, I think, you had George Soros, you may know that name as an investor, decided that the pound in Britain was overvalued, and attacked the currency. So he spent a lot of money shorting the British pound, and the Bank of England spent a lot of money, which in that day was a huge amount of money, I think it was £6 billion, to defend the currency. And we look at that, and at the time thought a huge amount of money, actually compared to what central banks have spent in the last 6 years in stimulating economies and rescuing their financial system, $6 billion is absolutely nothing. So after the Bank of England and the pound crisis with Soros, I think next would have come 94. So in 94, you had Mexico default on their debt. And a little closer to home, but closer to Mexico, Orange County defaulted. They got on the wrong side of some derivative trades when the Fed hiked interest rates in 94. After that, I think the next big highlight would have been the Asia financial crisis. So Asia, interesting enough, had its financial crisis 10 years before our global financial crisis. And I was reminded of that when I went to Asia, when I started to visit there in 2010, 2011, and I would be in meetings and people would talk about, oh, in the GFC, since GFC, GFC, and I'm like, what in the world is the GFC? And I realized that's what they were talking, or that's what they're referring to when they're talking about the global financial crisis. Because their crisis was 10 years before. They viewed what happened in 2007, 2008 as the Western financial crisis. It was depersonalized for them. It didn't matter as much. So they really had their crisis in 97. After Asia, what did you have? I might have to cheat here, guys. Sorry. You had, all the events of 98. You had Russia default. You had long-term capital management, a hedge fund in Greenwich, Connecticut default. You had Argentina then default in late 90s into 2000. 2000, you had the dot-com bubble burst. Then it was kind of quiet in the early 2000s until I think it was in 07 is when, 07, early 08 is when Iceland, do you remember Iceland collapsing? Again, they are, their banking system collapsed and their government had to bail it out, resulting in sovereign collapse as well. Again, sounds familiar. At the time, it was before all the events kicked off in the summer of 08, but at the time, the saying was there was one difference between Iceland and Ireland. It was just one letter, and we saw that became true when Ireland unfortunately followed suit. So after Iceland, you then had our global financial crisis, the GFC. In 07, 08, really 08, I'll put that. And then in 2010, you had the European sovereign debt crisis. So this was the first 25 years of my career in finance. And if you're thinking about a career in finance, hopefully you'll have as much excitement as I've had. But wanted to spend, I guess, a little time today, maybe the next 20 minutes or so, recapping my career and some of those highlights. But more importantly, maybe pausing on some of the lessons that I learned along the way. And I'd say these are really maybe the six things that I wish I knew when I was sitting in your seats or when I was walking around and studying at this great institution. So as Kelly said, I graduated in 89. I was an economics major, so similar to Kelly and some of you out there. I did not have a clue what I wanted to do with that degree. I actually didn't have a lot of experience or knowledge about Wall Street or careers in finance. I didn't have relatives or lots of relatives that, you know, exposed me to that early on. I didn't know about internships. I didn't do internships. I'm sure they were out there, but I didn't know about them. So I really didn't have a great plan when I was graduating university. And as a result, it took me a while to find a job. But eventually, I did find a job. My aunt, my dad's sister, was working in the Chase Manhattan Bank at the time. And she said to me, you've studied economics. What about banking? Why don't you interview for a job at the Chase Manhattan Bank? So I did, and I interviewed for a job. And I ended up in a very entry-level position in retail banking. And I was in the World Trade Center branch of the Chase Manhattan Bank, sitting at a desk, opening accounts and mortgages and credit cards. And that was my entry into banking. So no fancy internships, no fancy analyst training programs or management training programs. Very different from what I'm sure you guys might be focused on or have available to you today. So I think that's lesson number one. One thing I wish I did a little better at was having a plan or just being aware, knowing what was out there. So I started off in banking at Chase in 1990, was again in a branch for a couple of years. Then I moved into personal banking, which was kind of high net worth individuals. They were sort of 50,000 and up in investable assets. And then from there moved into private banking, and that's where I was working with more of the wealth, they called them the wealthy families. So these were individuals or families that had 50 million and up in assets. And it was interesting working with them. You would do banking, but there was also trust type structures that they would want to set up to transfer wealth to future generations. There was certainly investing for them, and that's the part I really liked, but they weren't doing very normal investments. They would also do quite sophisticated hedging strategies, so they'd be investing in, you know, private equity or alternative investments. And then there was lending, but it wasn't like, you know, lending to, you know, buy a house or have a credit card. It was like buying a boat or buying a plane. I remember working with a client and they were buying a plane. I think it was $30 million or something. And the plane had to fly around first with the pilot for the test flight. And I was standing by the phone waiting for the plane to land. And then they would tell me, you can move the money and pay for the plane. You know, crazy stuff. So that was private banking, which was very, very interesting. And I love the investment aspect. And I had the opportunity to move from New York to London in 2000. And I tried to move within private banking, but Chase at the time did not have a good private bank in London. They were actually going through some restructuring. But I moved from private banking into asset management. And that was the part of my job that I kind of liked the best. And there was a team in London that actually was managing money for one of my clients. So they already knew them, and they found out I was moving, and they said, yes, we'd love to hire you on the team. We've got a job opening. So that's how I kind of moved into asset management. And then the first 2 years that I was in London, there was three mergers. Okay, not JP Morgan. I was with Chase at the time. Chase bought a little British bank called Robert Fleming's. So it became Chase Fleming's. No sooner had that deal closed when they announced Chase-JP Morgan merger. And then the firm I was working for became JP Morgan. And then I think in 2002, JP Morgan purchased Bank One, a bank in the United States that had a chairman called Jamie Dimon, who then became the chairman of JP Morgan. So a little bit of turmoil there the first few years on the ground in London, quite a few mergers to digest and live through. And it was in 2001, as Kelly said, that I moved into the global liquidity business and in asset management. I'll try to explain what that is. It's the very conservative end of managing money for clients. And when I was with private banking, I was working with private individuals and families. With asset management, you're working with institutions. And by institutions, it could be institutions like the University of Richmond. It could be companies. It could be pension funds. It could be hedge funds. Anything that's just not a person or an individual, it's a company. So the global liquidity business was the very conservative end where you're managing money for companies. And it's their balance sheet cash. So they've already taken risk in creating the profits of whatever they might do, whether it's Apple or Nike or what have you. And the money has to be looked after in a conservative way. So that business was very large for JP Morgan at the time. And I was on the team in London. And it was a pan-European team. And like I had several different mergers when I first arrived there, from the time I joined the liquidity team in 2001 to 2005, I actually had three different bosses. So the first guy that hired me ended up moving on. Then the person that took his place was in place for a couple of years. Then he ended up moving to go to Barclays, which is now BlackRock. And then there was a new boss in place. And that guy was James. And James ended up leaving after 6 months to go join Mark at Barclays. And during this time, I'd had a couple of different roles on the team, and I was kind of one of the senior salespeople. And it's really funny, because after James left, I remember thinking, I wonder who our new boss is going to be. I don't remember thinking, oh, I wonder if I could be the new boss. You know, it just didn't really enter my mind. But someone said to me, Kathleen, are you going to apply for the job? And I thought, yeah, well, why not, right? So I did, and I applied for the head of the team, and it was really down to me. And this other guy called Andy, who worked in the US. And the head of the business was a guy called Bob. And Andy and I both interviewed for the job. And I got a call from Bob. And Bob said, look, Kathleen, thank you so much for, you know, interviewing, da 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 da. I've decided to go with Andy. OK. You know, I was disappointed, but not devastated. And I said, okay, that's fine. I'm disappointed, but I support your decision. He said, look, you know, Andy's not lived overseas before. He's not run a sales team. He's going to need a lot of your support. I still want you to be his, you know, right-hand person, and we're going to continue to expand your role. And I said, okay, thanks. You know, that's great. And I waited a day or two, and I'm waiting for the announcement to come out for Andy's new job. And nothing happens. And then I get called by another very senior person who's happened to be based in London. And he and Bob, this guy's name was Jamie. Jamie and Bob were like peers. And there were some other senior people in London at the time within management. And Jamie called me. He said, Kathleen, did you want that job? And I said, yeah, I wanted the job. I interviewed for it. I said, but Bob's going with Andy. He said, I wouldn't be so sure about that. OK. Then I got a call from Bob. Bob says, hi, Kathleen, I've changed my mind. I'd like you to take the job. So what had happened, unbeknownst to me at the time, was that I had supporters. Today we call them sponsors, people senior, more senior than me in the organization, that overruled my boss, which is kind of, you know, strange for that to happen, overruled Bob's decision and basically said, we don't think you should bring Andy over. We think you should give Kathleen the job. I was kind of already the acting head at the time. So that leads me to lesson number two, which is develop mentors and sponsors. I do that now. I hadn't done it at that point in my career because I didn't even know they were out there. But I think about people that you will look to. You'll look for advice. You'll bounce ideas off of. Those are mentors. You build a relationship of people that you can that can help mentor you, help give you advice, help get you through times in your career. And then if you're lucky, sometimes those mentor relationships can actually transform into more sponsorships. And I think sponsorship, I think of as people that are willing to, you know, put their career on the line for you or go to bat for you. And that's clearly what I had in London at the time, and I didn't realize it. So think about this. I'm now, you know, starting off in the role, and my boss doesn't even like me, right? I'm like number two choice. So I felt like I had a lot, you know, to learn and to prove myself. But things were going well, and I would say, you know, several months into it, I knew that there was a promotion cycle coming up, and I knew that the two of the past three people that were in that job, so the guy that lasted 6 months didn't get there, but the other two were managing directors, which is the, you know, kind of highest level you could get to that I aspired to. And so I said to Bob, you know, are you putting me forward for promotion to managing director this year? And he said, nope. And that's when I think for the first time in my career, I really felt severe disappointment because I thought it wasn't fair. He's not acknowledging the work I've done. You know, the team is performing. He wasn't willing to put me forward. So I was really angry and really disappointed. And that's fine. You're allowed to be, right? So, but I got, you know, kind of got over it. And I thought, well, I'm going to prove him wrong. I'm going to work twice as hard this year. And I'm going to make him see that he should have given me the promotion or this was the year for me. So I did that. I worked very hard. The following year, I did get promoted. So it meant, I think, even more because it, you know, was something that I felt I had to work hard for. And I remember being very, very proud of the achievement and the accomplishment. I think I picked up the phone and the first call I made was to my dad, who's here tonight. And it was just a very big moment. And I would say that would be my third lesson, is how you handle disappointment. And you guys will be disappointed. You'll have setbacks, you'll have failures, things won't go right. But how you handle that will define you. So it will define, you know, people watch how you handle things, how you bounce back, how you take criticism on board, how you take feedback on board, all of that good stuff is very defining. So lesson number three, how you handle disappointment. So fast forward, what year would this have been? This would have been like 2006, early 2007. Things were going great, right? I'm managing this wonderful team in London, a European business for JP Morgan Asset Management. You know, the managing director thing has come through. We're the number one firm in my industry. The global liquidity business, JP Morgan, was number one, still is today. Goldman Sachs is number three. So, you know, everything's going wonderful. And then a little thing called the global financial crisis hits. But it wasn't actually called that when it hit in like 07, 08. It was called the US subprime crisis. It was just confined to one country and one little part of the mortgage market. We know that certainly wasn't true, but that's how it started. And it actually started in the money markets. So the business that I was in and managing money for these clients, that's where the first issues started to crop up. And in 2007, 2008, I remember the year 08 clearly because it was sort of bookended by Bear Stearns in March, the 17th, and then Lehman in September. But that was an incredibly stressful time. So the weekend that Bear Stearns failed, everyone sort of knew. They were watching Bear Stearns becoming more and more insolvent through the week. Their liquidity was drying up. Their funding sources were drying up. People were stopping lending to them. And going into the weekend, I think on the Friday, it was announced that JP Morgan had extended some credit lines or put their guaranteed some of Bear Stearns' lines. So basically put JP's credit behind Bear. And then through the weekend, you know, the management team, Jamie's management team and others came together and structured a deal. And on Sunday night, it was announced that JP bought Bear for $2 a share, which was a huge fall from grace where that share had been trading, but basically rescued this failing institution, for the U.S., and you know, the U.S. government was certainly encouraging JP to do so. They ended up having to restructure the deal, and the price went to $10 a share because of some things that were wrong in the contract, and I think there was a bit of outrage over the price at the time, and I think restructuring the deal a week later also gave JP Morgan a little better understanding of what they were buying. I mean, Jamie Dimon at the time famously tells a story when he had to go and testify in front of Congress about how this happened, and he tried to make it simple for the politicians to understand. And he said, rather than, you know, it's one thing to buy a house, it's another thing to buy a house that's on fire, because you don't know when the flames go out what you're left with. And that was kind of exactly what Bear Stearns was. So that was March of 08, rather. And then that summer, leading into that summer and the events of that summer, the news just got worse and worse, right? You had Citibank, huge write-downs, Merrill, huge write-downs. And you started to see banks in Europe, like UK banks and certainly Irish banks. So suddenly this little problem in, you know, the US subprime market was a lot bigger than people thought. And the contagion began to spread. Leading into September, you had, late August, you had Fannie and Freddie going under, filing for receivership. And then was the events of the Lehman weekend. And I think anyone that was working at that time can tell you exactly where they were. I remember exactly where I was that weekend because I was in New York. My dad was getting married to my stepmom that weekend. So I was in New York. And the phone rang. Sunday night, I'm at JFK, ready to fly back to London. And it was Bob. And Bob says, Kathleen, where are you? And I said, I'm in JFK, I'm getting ready to get on a plane. What's going on? And he said, well, I got bad news. We just found out that no one's gonna rescue Lehman. The government's not stepping in and the banks can't agree. So they're gonna file. And they're gonna file probably within hours because they need to file before Asia opens. So when you land in London, I have no idea what the state of play is gonna be, but you know, kind of be ready for anything. And that was the understatement. So I, you know, remember you have to turn off your phone, right? Wheels off the ground, and I couldn't turn my BlackBerry on fast enough the next morning just to see what the hell was happening. And I remember I was flying with carry-on, and I went like straight to the office. And you know, for the next, I would say, you know, several weeks, it was awful. On the phone all the time with clients, trying to explain to them what you knew. And people didn't all know a lot that was going on, but you had to stay in front of your clients and give them as much information as possible. And I think you really can build very strong relationships when you're picking up the phone and talking to people in tough times. Had to go in and like rally my team and make them feel, you know, positive and motivated to pick up the phone and you know, all of that good stuff. But it was very, very stressful for me personally. But that leads me to my next lesson, which is remaining calm under pressure. And I think that's really important, especially as you go through your career. There's going to be times that are stress-filled, hopefully nothing that stressful. But being able to maintain, you know, composure, even if you don't feel it, take a step away, get your composure. You know, if you're going to talk to someone and you feel, you know, that you're not going to deliver the best message because you're quite stressed or what have you, you know, trying to be calm and channel some calmness under pressure and stressful times would definitely be my next big lesson for you guys. So moving to like 09, and I would say that by any measure, JP Morgan actually had a very good crisis. They were seen to have a very strong management team and Jamie and his team. Jamie had a mantra of building a fortress balance sheet, right? He wanted to build a fortress balance sheet that was very much recognized by people when they were looking for a safe home for their money. They were giving it to JP Morgan. My business was not JP Morgan's balance sheet, but it was asset management of JP Morgan, and I think we definitely had a halo effect. So we saw, you know, good performance in my business through that time. So things were going great. Wasn't looking to change my situation at all, but in 2010, I got a call from Goldman Sachs. And again, not looking to leave JP Morgan, but come on, it was Goldman Sachs, right? So you wanna go find out if anything, they were one of my big competitors, and I wanted to find out what were they thinking of doing? Are they hiring people? Are they building out? So I went to the meeting, Said straight away, I'm not looking to leave JP Morgan. But we started talking, and you know, they didn't really take no for an answer at first. And they would say, okay, that's fine. We don't want you to leave, but we'd like you to meet one more person. You know, and the more people I met, and the more I talked to them, the more I liked what I was hearing. And the opportunity to leave JP was to go to Goldman and have the global head role of the liquidity business. So the same business at Goldman, but basically have the Bob job, right? Get to be the one in charge globally, be more creative with my strategy, own something. So it became more and more interesting, and I'm you know, writing down the pluses and the minuses in the column. And everything I thought was lining up positive for moving over to Goldman, with the exception of a 20-year track record at another firm. And I thought, well, how am I ever going to build that network again? How am I going to know how to get things done? Who's going to know who Kathleen Hughes is when I pick up the phone? You know, all of these things, like, to start over at that point and build something again just felt daunting. So, and it felt like there was a fair degree of risk in making this move. But I talked to a lot of people, got a lot of advice. I'm sure I got advice from that guy right there, my dad. And I decided to make the move. And that leads me to my fifth lesson for you guys, is don't be afraid to take risk. Take risk in your career. You know, analyze it, figure out how you can mitigate it, but definitely take risk and look for opportunities to do that. I would say that for me personally, the risk was incredibly well worth it. I love JP Morgan, and my husband still works there, so I can't say anything bad about that organization. Of course, Kelly is going to work there, so I really can't say anything bad about that organization. But for me personally, the last, you know, 3.5 years at Goldman have been fantastic. The business, getting to run the global business and getting to travel to different parts of the world that I never thought I would see, getting to build out a business in China, you know, just opportunities I never thought I'd see. Meeting people from all parts of the world, meeting clients in different regions and comparing their stories, working with different cultures, all of that was something that I never really had at JP Morgan, not until I got the global role at Goldman. The people there are very smart and motivated. I learn something every day. It's really a pleasure to work there. Fast forward to this past September, and they actually asked me to take on an additional role. So in addition to the head of the global liquidity sales team, I'm now also the head of our European institutional business, which means working, again, still with institutional clients, but instead of working with very conservative investments for corporate balance sheets, I'm working with broad institutions, mostly pension funds and insurance companies, across all the asset classes that Goldman manages. So alternatives, you know, emerging market debt, high yield debt, equity markets. So a whole new range of products to understand and a whole new set of clients to meet and understand. So I continue to learn every day. And you know, the second role has been wonderful. It's been a little bit like drinking out of a fire hose from time to time. And they say if you want something done, give it to a busy person, which is, I guess, why they gave me the new job and didn't take away the old job. But it's been incredible. So when I look back to, you know, my days here, I never, ever, I think we talked, Jen and I talked about, I never would have imagined, you know, that I would be living in London, running a global business, running another European business. I mean, it was just completely off the radar screen of what I ever would have imagined. So that leads me to my sixth lesson, and that is dream big, okay? Because big things can happen, dream big. And I'll tell a small story that will also allow me to kind of touch on one of my other passions, and that's the Women's Network. I'm the co-head of the Women's Network for my division in Europe, and so I'm very active with the diversity agenda there. And we had Sheryl Sandberg come to speak to Goldman. And that's another thing. Since I've worked at Goldman, I've had these opportunities to hear from all these amazing leaders in business and politics. They bring in speakers for sometimes just for the employees, other times it's for clients, and I've been at different client events. But since I've been there, I have heard from Hillary Clinton, Nicolas Sarkozy, Madeleine Albright, Malcolm Gladwell, Michael Johnson during the London Olympics, Joe Malone, does anyone know Joe Malone Fragrances? And okay, just met her a couple of weeks ago. She did a really good talk. And then, of course, Sheryl Sandberg did this talk that really stuck with me. So she was on kind of her book tour. And I'm assuming you all know Sheryl Sandberg, Facebook COO, nodding heads, okay. So she's on her kind of her book tour after the Lean In book comes out. And she is invited to speak at Goldman Sachs by Gary Cohen, who's our president. He did speak here, Jim, a year ago. Did anyone see him speak? Gary? Okay. So Gary introduces Sheryl, and he does her introduction. She gets up. It's clear they know each other well. He sits back down. This is in the auditorium at the headquarters, and it probably seats about 300 people. And this one was just for kind of senior management was in the auditorium, or senior leadership across the firm, I would say, was in the auditorium. It was probably 70% women, maybe 30% men. And so if you're thinking about it, it's the most senior, probably most senior group of women in the firm. Sheryl starts her talk off by asking the audience a question. And she says, if you've ever said these words out loud to your friend, your husband, your wife, your partner, or to yourself in the mirror, or to the family dog, I want you to raise your hand if you've ever said these words out loud. And the words are, I want to be CEO of Goldman Sachs. And you looked at the room, every guy had his hand up, including Gary, which is quite funny since he's number two. But only a handful of the women had their hand up. And that's how Sheryl kind of started her talk, and that's what she built on, what she thought some of the reasons behind that were, and she went on to speak about it. But that was, I thought, really, that made a very big impression on me. So, again, I implore all of you to dream big. But for the women in the room, really dream big, or at least dream as big as the guy sitting next to you.